The aim of my intervention is to address the issue of why economic growth is not compatible with environmental sustainability, and the motivation behind it is the need to fill the gap between science and policy making. For every substantive statement that I make, I provide a reference in the text which has been made available, so that my intervention is structured as a literature review. Growth for the sake of growth remains the credo of all governments and international institutions. Economic growth is presented as the panacea that can solve any of the world's problems, poverty, inequality, sustainability, you name it. However, there is an uncomfortable scientific truth that has to be faced. Economic growth is environmentally unsustainable. Then the central question becomes, how can we manage an economy without growth? Economist Kenneth Boulding famously said that anyone who believes that exponential growth can go on forever in a finite world is either a madman or an economist, end of the quote. Now, ecological economists argue that the economy is physical, while mainstream economists seem to believe it is metaphysical. Social metabolism is the study of energy and material flows within the economy. So, on the input side of the economy, key material resources are limited, and many are peaking, including oil and phosphorus. On the output side of the economy, because of thermodynamics, everything that enters into the economy has to come out at some point. So on the output side, humanity is trespassing planetary boundaries. Climate change is the evidence of the limited assimilative capacity of ecosystems. It is the planet saying, enough is enough. Now, mainstream economists, finally convinced by the existence of biophysical limits, started to argue that economic growth can be decoupled from the consumption of energy and materials, or from environmental impacts, that is the same thing. Now, historical data series like material flow accounting from Eurostat, for instance, demonstrate that this, up to now, has not happened. At most, there is relative decoupling, that is, a decrease in resource use per unit of GDP. But there is no absolute decoupling, that is what matters for sustainability, which is an absolute decrease of environmental resource consumption. Now, the only periods of absolute dematerialization coincide with economic recession. Trade should also be taken into account to avoid externalization of pollution-intensive activities outside the European Union, the so-called pollution heaven hypothesis. Now, the current economy cannot be circular, the main reason being that energy cannot be recycled and materials only up to a certain extent. The global economy currently recycles less than 10% of materials. About 50% of processed materials are used to provide energy and are thus not available for recycling. It is basically fossil fuels. It is simple. Economic growth is not compatible with environmental sustainability. The list of nice oxymorons is long, from sustainable development to its reincarnation, like green economy or green growth. But wishful thinking does not solve real problems. Increasing GDP leads to increasing material and energy use, and therefore to environmental unsustainability. Now, technology and market-based solutions are not magic bullets. Faith in technology has become religious. Scientific evidence shows that, based on past trends in technological improvement, these are coming way too slowly to avoid irreversible climate change. For instance, efficiency improvement leads to rebound effect in the context of economic growth. This is, the more efficient you are, the more you consume. Think of cars. Cars have become more and more efficient, but the total consumption of gasoline has increased, not decreased. So renewable energy produces less net energy because it has a lower energy return on investment than fossil fuels. For this and other reasons, renewable energy cannot satisfy current levels of energy consumption, which therefore needs to be reduced. Most of the world's fossil fuels reserves must be left in the ground, unburned, to keep global temperature rise to no more than 2 degrees Celsius. In fact, fossil fuels should be called unburnable fuels. Science sometimes brings bad news, I'm sorry. An article recently published in Nature Sustainability argued that no country in the world meets the basic needs of citizens at the global sustainable level of resource use, end of the quote. The question then becomes, how can the condition for a good life for all within planetary boundaries be generated? The uncomfortable truth to be faced by policymaking is the following. First, Economic growth is ecologically unsustainable. The total consumption of material and energy needs to be reduced, starting from developed countries. Second, economic growth might also not be socially desirable. Inequality are on the rise, poverty is not being eliminated, and life satisfaction is stagnant. Third, economic growth is fueled by debt. Think, for example, of quantitative easing, which correspond to a colonization, to a mortgaging of the future. This debt cannot be paid, and the financial system is still prone to instability, despite Basilea III. What to do? For instance, scientifically, it's not clear to me how the European Union will achieve a low-carbon economy in a context of economic growth, since it implies a reduction of greenhouse gas emissions to 80% below 1990 levels by 2050. In fact, climatologists Kevin Anderson and Alice Bowes have argued convincingly that for a reasonable probability of avoiding the 2 degrees Celsius characterization of dangerous climate change, the wealthier the Annex I nations need, temporarily, to adopt a degrowth strategies. End of the quote. Obviously, a transition from a growth society to a degrowth or post-growth one poses several challenges, it's obvious. However, the emerging field of ecological macroeconomics is starting to address these challenges convincingly. Happiness and economics literature, for example, show that GDP growth is not needed for well-being, because there are other important determinants, and I think here of the Easterlin paradox. High life expectancy is compatible with low carbon emissions, but high incomes are not. Moreover, lack of growth might increase inequalities, unless there is redistribution. In any case, the issue is not whether we shall abandon economic growth, the question is how. Scientific debates around it are on the rise, but I'm afraid policy making is behind. There are good signs. Critics of GDP as an indicator of well-being are common, even mainstream, I would say. There are degrowth policy proposals, and these are entering into the parliaments. This is not new. For example, in 1972, Sikon Mansell, a Dutch social democrat, who was then the EU Commissioner for Agriculture, brought a letter to the then President of the European Commission, Franco Maria Malfatti, urging him to seriously take into account limits to growth in the EU economic policy. Mansion himself became the President of the European Commission after only 2 months from the letter, but for a too short term to push for a zero or below zero growth agenda. Nowadays, I think the time is ripe not only for a scientific degrowth research agenda that exists, but also for a political one. As ecological economists Tim Jackson and Peter Victor argued in the New York Times, imagining a world without growth is among the most vital and urgent tasks for society to engage in. Thank you.